You know what you're listening to? You're listening to the Deen Team, bringing the light of Islam right into your hearts.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Welcome our dear listeners to the program, to another episode on the Deen Team. With you today, your brother in Islam, Malaz Majani. And today we want to speak about some of the meanings that are behind Surah Al-Asr. Surah Al-Asr, which is Surah 103, chapter 103 in the Quran. A very surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. الله سبحانه وتعالى says by the time, he takes an oath by the time, he says verily man is in loss except those who believe and do righteous good deeds and recommend one another to the truth and recommend one another to the patience. Having patience. SubhanAllah, I mean, inshallah we'll go a bit deeper into the meanings, but this is a very, very basic translation of the three verses within this surah. It's a very short surah. You often hear it and we often read it in our prayers and we use it. SubhanAllah, you find that even our young ones and our children have memorized it. However, what's so significant about the surah is that the meanings within, the interpretation of the surah are so significant that if we truly understood the meanings and grasped the dimensions, our lives would completely change. SubhanAllah, you find that if you act upon this surah, you will succeed in the dunya and in the akhirah. And whosoever does not act upon this surah has indeed lost his dunya and his akhirah. Waliyadu billah. Surah Al-Asr is a great miracle. It's, subhanAllah, it's very brief in wording but very heavy in sense. It encompasses all the causes of happiness in its entirety and warns on the causes of all sorrows. SubhanAllah, if the most eloquent of people were to write the causes of happiness and the causes of sorrow, they would need multiple volumes of books and books, and even that would not achieve the objective. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the meanings and the causes of happenings and the meanings and causes of sorrows in three verses within the Quran. This surah is a Makki surah, which means it was revealed before the time of Hijrah to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Imam al-Shafi'i said something very important about this surah. He says, لو ما أنزل الله حجة على خلقه إلا هذه السورة لكفتهم. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down only the surah, it would have sufficed. SubhanAllah. And he also said something else that's very beautiful. He said that people are negligent of this surah and its meanings. SubhanAllah. Imam al-Shafi'i, a great scholar, telling us about the importance of this surah. You find in the Quran, there are links between one surah and the one after it. And there are even links within the surah itself between the different ayat. And the surah before Surah Al-Asr is Surah Al-Takathur. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala finishes Surah Al-Takathur by saying, ثُمَّ لَتُسْأَلُنَّ يَوْمَئِذٍ عَنِ النَّعِيمِ. That verily, you will then be asked on that day, on the day of judgment, about the blessing. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is connecting that surah with the Asr, indicating to us that one of the biggest blessings, one of the biggest na'im that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us is time. SubhanAllah. And you even find that there is a central theme in Surah Al-Takathur, that increasing in wealth, increasing in property, increasing in materialistic items, and that's for Surah Al-Takathur. And then for Surah Al-Asr, there is a central theme of loss. SubhanAllah. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that when you increase and increase and increase in your dunya and have too much dunya and you're forgetful about the akhirah, that will lead to loss. SubhanAllah. Insan is immersed in a state of loss, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. And subhanAllah, this ayah and these are the verses within this surah, it's like it has an end statement. That there are four conditions you must fulfill. You must fulfill A and B and C and D, which is different to an or statement, for example. So for example, or statement, you would say you can either do this or that. But in this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that you must believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You must do righteous deeds. You must also recommend one another for patience, and you must also recommend one another for what is right, for what is good. So we must, achieve every single one of these conditions. So it's not optional. And subhanAllah, these are the four actions that people tend to overlook. Normally when you think about religion, you think about praying, you think about fasting, you think about hajj, you think about salah. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that there are important things as well in our religion that we must fulfill. SubhanAllah, this surah, in a way, it summarizes the Qur'an. It summarizes our deen, and it even summarizes the message of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And it's interesting to note that the surah does not discuss, it doesn't discuss who is not a failure. It discusses, who's above the failing grade. It doesn't talk about entering Jannah or earning Jannah. It's about being saved from hellfire. It doesn't talk about success, but it's more of survival mode. You are talking about, survival. And before you start talking about high levels and achieving success and high levels in Jannah, you need to make sure that you are survival. When survival is in place, everything else takes second priority, takes the back seat. And this surah as well, it has a sense of urgency. It has a sense of urgency, and it discusses the bare minimum required in our religion. SubhanAllah, and as we mentioned, it doesn't make any sense to discuss success and high levels if survival is at stake. SubhanAllah, this surah proves that being good on your own is not enough. You must have concern for other people. You're not doing it for others, you are doing it actually for yourself. And it necessitates this quest for others for your own salvation, subhanAllah. And whenever two sahaba used to meet, they would never leave each other's company, until they recite the surah. Wal asri inna al-insana lafi khusr illa alladhina amanu wa amilu salihati wa tawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bil sabr. It's as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving me and you a reminder and advice. And talking about the demands is very easy. However, like internalizing and putting these things into practice is the difficult part that we must take on, inshallah. And subhanAllah, all human beings are in desperate need for survival. Everyone is. No exceptions. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins the first ayah by saying, wal asr. And he takes an oath subhanahu wa ta'ala by time, indicating that there is an importance to time. And this oath that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes also manifests some sort of anger. And, when you say, I swear by something, it's a matter of importance. It indicates grandeur. This is the last oath in the Qur'an that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes. He makes an oath by wal duha, he says wal tur, wal najm. But wal asr is the last oath that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes. And as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is telling us that time is a witness to the tragedy of human life, heading in the wrong direction. Nation after nation after nation, we've shown you example after example of how you can go and be led astray, and how you can fail in this test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And literally the word asr means time is running out. It's like the last ebb of the day. And subhanAllah, Salat al-Asr is at the end of the day, when the day is running out. And there's an association with a sense of urgency there. It's the sunset. It's towards the sunset of your life. And you can compare this to an ice vendor in the olden days. If he doesn't sell the ice melts and he is in loss. SubhanAllah, some ulama have said that the time is referred to here is the era and time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Other ulama have gone to the opinion that this time is the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his age, 63 years, that resulted in the transformation of humanity. 63 years that changed humanity from being miserable to being happy, took him from darkness to light, from the lowest ranks to the highest of ranks. A very valuable and priceless 63 years. SubhanAllah, if we compare our life to the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what have we done? Bought a house, built a business, we're an employee, we've gained a degree. Wallahi, if we compare our achievements to that of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we really realize how trivial our achievements are. All of humanity who is guided is in the books of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why he is in the highest of ranks. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew exactly how to use his asr, how to use his time, and to make the best of his life every hour, every minute. And the guidance he has given us is the reason why his time was priceless. Other ulama have gone to the meaning and gone to the opinion that asr is talking about the value of time. And if we analyze this life, this dunya, we find that the most valuable thing that we have is time. Umar ibn Abdul Aziz said, night and day consume you, so consume them in good action. SubhanAllah, look at a picture of yourself 20 or 30 years ago. How much time has consumed you? How much has this time consumed you? Your skin is not the same. Your hair is so much less. Your health, the energy, all consumed by time. And if you multiply the 60, 70 years that you might live by the days and by the hours and by the minutes that you have, you get a fairly large number. But that's the age of the human. I mean, the human is a finite number of days. And every day that goes, every minute that goes, every moment that goes, is a portion gone from you. Your time is either invested in good actions, or it can be consumed and wasted. Waliyadu billah. And the biggest regret, the greatest heartbreak on the day of judgment, is an hour in this life that was wasted. SubhanAllah, look into your life and try and think about which hours are going to waste. What have you done in this day, in this week, in this month? How did you spend your time? Did you forget Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Did you forget the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Our pious predecessors, when one of the pious predecessors was asked, how often do you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He says, and so hatta adhkurah, I do not forget him so that I need to remember him. SubhanAllah, they were constantly in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we all know the hadith by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated in Tirmidhi, that the feet of the son of Adam will not move. He will remain standing there on the day of judgment until he is asked about five things. Concerning his life, how he spent it. Concerning his youth, how he grew old. Concerning his wealth, how he acquired it, and in what way he spent it. And what it was that he did with the knowledge that he had. And Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to call on the Muslims to take the initiative to do good deeds before any obstacles arise. He said, lose no time to do good deeds before you are caught up by one of the seven calamities awaiting you. A starvation which may impair your wisdom. A prosperity which may mislead you. An ailment which may damage your health. An old age which may harm your senses. A sudden death, or the Dajjal, or the doomsday, which is indeed the hardest and the most bitter. Do not be from the people, my brothers and sisters in Islam, that say, Ya laytani qaddamtu li hayati. Oh, I wish I had sent ahead some good for my life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this other ayah that the true life is in the hereafter. The life that we are in today is only temporary. This person says, he's in the pinnacle of regret. I wish I was a believer. I wish I had learnt about Allah. I wish I had spent more time for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, as soon as the holidays begin, I'll start reading Quran. As soon as I finish my degree, I'll start attending gatherings of ilm. The most valuable thing that you have in this life is Quran, is your time. Compare yourself. Do you spend your time reading novels or reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took an oath by time because it is the most crucial and the most valuable asset that you have. You can buy everything you want, but you can't buy time. SubhanAllah, every minute that goes will never come back. Will never come back. SubhanAllah, Al-Masih alayhi salam, Jesus alayhi salam, Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam said, إِنَّ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ خِزَانَتَانِ فَانْظُرُوا مَاذَا تَضَعُونَ فِيهِمَا. He said, like, he gave a beautiful analogy, that the day and the night are like two big cupboards. So look what you put inside of them. And Umar ibn Khattab said, حَاسِبُوا أَنفُسَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُحَاسَبُوا. Judge yourself before you are judged. وَزِنُوا أَعْمَالَكُمْ قَبْلَ أَن تُوزَنَ عَلَيْكُمْ. And weigh out your deeds before they are weighed out for you. And do not be from the people that say, you know, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَالْتَنظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدٍ وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is commanding us here. He says, O you who believe, fear Allah and let every soul look at what provision He has sent forth for the morrow. So do not waste your time in this life. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us another ayah clarifying. He says, وَأَنْفِقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يَأْتِيَ أَحَدَكُمُ الْمَوْتُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّ لَوْلَا أَخَّرْتَنِي إِلَىٰ أَجَلٍ قَرِيبٍ فَأَصَّدَّقَ وَأَكُمْ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. He says, and spend in the way of Allah from what we have provided you before death approaches one of you. And he says, my Lord, if only you would delay me for a brief term, so I would give charity and be amongst the righteous. SubhanAllah, now we have an opportunity to give in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give charity for the sake of Allah. We have an opportunity to be amongst the righteous. Do not be from the people that wait until it's too late and the opportunity is gone. SubhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us another example in the Quran where he says, حَتَّى إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتُ قَالَ رَبِّ ارْجِعُونَ لَعَلِّي أَعْمَلُ صَالِحًا فِي مَا تَرَكْتْ. When death comes to one of them, he says, my Lord, send me back. Send me back, take me back to the dunya, that I might do some righteous deeds in that which I left behind. Then what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says? كَلَّا. No, It's not going to happen. إنها كلمة هو قائلها. It's only a word that he is saying. Allah, oh, ومن ورائهم برزخ إلى يوم يبعثون. And behind them is a barrier until the day they are resurrected. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes an oath by time, because this time is the most valuable commodity that you possess. Or he makes an oath by the priceless age of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even when he joked, his joking was haqq. We all know the story of when a lady came up to him and asked him if she will enter paradise. And he told her that no old lady will enter paradise. So the lady became very upset. And then he asked her, why are you upset? She said, because he said, no old lady will enter paradise. He said, because when you enter paradise, you will enter paradise as a young lady. Subhanallah. So even his joking, when he joked, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his joking was haqq. He spoke out against evil. He never left an opportunity for enjoining what is good and for forbidding what is evil. Aisha radiallahu anha tells us that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made use of his day and night. He made use of his night, and he would pray the night until his feet would swell. He made good use of his day, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, there's like more than 100,000 ahadith narrated by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, showing us the way. If only we knew the true value of time, wallahi we would not waste 1 second or a minute or be forgetful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even for a mere moment. I mean, you have to imagine that there's a bank which credits your account every morning with $86,400. Every single morning. It carries over no balance from day to day. It allows you to keep no cash balance. And every evening, it cancels whatever part of the amount you have failed to use during the day. What would you do? You would withdraw out every cent, of course. Every single day, you would make sure that you pull out all the money and use it. Or save it. Well, everyone has such a bank, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. And this bank is called time. Every morning, it credits you with 86,400 seconds. And every night, it writes off as lost whatever of this you have failed to invest for good purpose. It carries over no balance, no overdraft. Each day opens a new account for you, and each night it burns the remains of the day. If you fail to use the day's deposits, the loss is yours. Subhanallah. I mean, to realize the value of a year, ask a student who's failed a grade. To realize the value of a month, ask a mother who's given birth to a premature baby. To realize the value of a week, ask an editor of a weekly newspaper how busy they are during the week. To realize the value of a day, ask a daily wage laborer who has kids to feed. To realize the value of an hour, ask the wife waiting for her husband. To realize the value of a minute, ask a person who missed the train. To realize the value of a second, ask the person who avoided an accident. To realize the value of 1 millisecond, ask the person who won the silver medal in the Olympics. Subhanallah. Even milliseconds have value in our lives, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Verily, man is in loss. Subhanallah. And the word inna in Arabic is used for a group of people who are in doubt about something. Are in doubt about something you want to say. And most humans, when they hear this, they don't believe it. I mean, inna is used to remove doubt. Don't think this is used for the kafir. Everyone, all of humanity is in loss except the insan. Except. There's an exception here. So there's a rule of except. There's an exception to the rule. And this insan, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word insan because insan is forgetful. And insan comes from the root word nasiya, because humans need to be reminded because they forget. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't use the word bashar or fard or nafs because he wanted to allude to our forgetfulness. And this word subhanAllah includes all categories, all humans, and it's singular. As if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is like diffusing the responsibility and talking to you directly. As if you're addressing one person, at least Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addressing one person directly. He says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Each and every individual forgetful human being is immersed in loss. I am in trouble. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking to me. On the day of judgment, it's all about the individual. The mother doesn't care about the child. يَوْمَ يَفِرُّ الْمَرْءُ مِنْ أَخِيهِ. The day the man will flee from his brother. وَأُمِّهِ وَأَبِيهِ. And his mother and his father. وَصَاحِبَتِهِ وَبَنِيهِ. His wife and children. لِكُلِّ امْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ شَأْنٌ يُغْنِيهِ. Every single man is on his own that day. He'll have a problem on his own. Something for him to worry him on that day. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that this is the time, now is the time when you should forget about everyone and worry about your salvation. Because on the day of judgment, that's the case. We are so worried about our children that we forget ourselves. I mean, I have to ensure that my child gets good education, that they have a good environment. What about your environment? I mean, why are you watching television shows? Why are you using swearing language if you don't want your child to speak like this? إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is bringing responsibility to yourself, to you directly, not as a group, to you individually. No doubt, each and every single human being, as forgetful as they are deeply immersed in a state of loss. And subhanallah, our measure of success. I mean, how do we measure success? Today, success is measured by someone being a millionaire, or someone having a big mansion, or his children are, mashallah, educated, they're doctors and engineers, and he has this and he has that. What is your perception of success? When you see a high achiever who has a great position, a big income, he drives a very expensive car, do you see this person as a success or a failure? I mean, the one who graduated is a success. The one who didn't is a failure. That's how people see it these days. And the one who's got a business that's thriving is a success, and the one that doesn't is a failure. That's how people see it these days. But the surah is realigning our understanding, and it's teaching us that these are not the measures of success or failure. If this person does not know Allah, this person does not pray, this person does not fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this person is a failure. The wealthy person is finished with death. I mean, the one who holds the highest of positions will end with death. In the grave, they bury him and they put the soil on top of him. None of his materialistic gains and his achievements and his money and wealth will do anything for him. In an instant, subhanallah, the human becomes news. I mean, he was a human that can hear, that can see. He had friends, he had enemies. Some used to fear him. He was Mr. Muhammad. He was now he's the late brother Muhammad, subhanallah, the deceased. He doesn't take with him but his deeds. This surah, if truly understood, would change lives, wallahi. This would make people repent, and would make people give in charity and be steadfast. I mean, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about khusr and loss in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us the story of Qarun. Inna Qaruna kana min qawmi Musa fabagha alayhim. That indeed Qarun was from the people of Musa. But he tyrannized them, and we gave him so much treasures that it would burden a strong team of men to carry the keys to his treasures. Not his treasures, to carry the keys to his treasures. Subhanallah. And his people said to him, don't exalt. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Allah la yuhibbu al-fariheen, Allah does not like the exultant. And then what did Qarun say? He said, I was only given it because of knowledge that I have. He attributed his wealth to himself. He didn't attribute to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked, he said the question in the Quran, did he not know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destroyed before him generations and generations who had much greater wealth and much more power and accumulation than him? Subhanallah. We often speak about the wealthy. Do you know how much his house is worth? Do you know how much he turns over in a year? Do you know how much the value of his business is? How many houses he has? How many cars? What the bank was like at his wedding? How many hotels he spends his time in? Subhanallah, one day Umar radiallahu anhu started to cry. He said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he walked into Rasulullah and found Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sleeping on a mat that had marked his side. So Umar began to cry and said, Ya Rasulullah, Kisra Malikul Furs yanamu ala al-harir. That Kisra, the king of the Furs, is sleeping on silk. Wa anta Rasulullah, and you are the Prophet of Allah, and you are sleeping on this mat. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected Umar's understanding, and he corrected our understanding. He told him, Ya Umar, أما ترضى أن تكون لهم الدنيا ولنا الآخرة؟ يا عمر إنما هي نبوة وليست ملكا. يا عمر, do you not accept that for them is the dunya and for us is the akhirah? يا عمر, it is prophethood that I have, not kingship. Subhanallah. عمر cried, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam corrected his understanding, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. And the story of Qarun is a very important story for us to understand what is true success. That success is not in wealth. Success is not in possession. Success is not in position. Look at Fir'aun. Subhanallah. I mean, if success was to do with houses, position, wealth, then Fir'aun would be success. But what happened to Fir'aun? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala drowned them. Because why? He says, and then subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed Musa and Bani Israel to cross through the ocean. And then when they crossed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closed the ocean on Fir'aun and his soldiers. And then what did Fir'aun say? قال آمنت أنه لا إله إلا الذي آمنت به بنو إسرائيل. He said, I believe that there is no deity except that in whom the children of Israel believe. And I, وأنا من المسلمين. He said, I am from the Muslims. What did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell him? الآن, now you want to believe, ya Fir'aun, and you have disobeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before, and you were from the people that were corrupt. Subhanallah. Don't wait until it's too late. Look at Namrud, subhanallah, the one whom he had a conversation with Ibrahim alayhi salam, And he said to Ibrahim, Allah, Ibrahim alayhi salam was telling him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Rabbi alladhi yuhyi wa yumeet. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that gives life and takes and causes death. So Namrud, he brought two prisoners, he killed one and he let one go. So he told Ibrahim, Ana wahyi wa yumeet. I can give life and I can take life. Subhanallah, just what he did. So when Ibrahim alayhi salam realized that this person does not understand, he doesn't understand, he used a different approach with him. He told him, فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْتِي بِالشَّمْسِ مِنَ الْمَشْرِقِ فَأْتِي بِهَا مِنَ الْمَغْرِبِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings up the sun from the east, so bring it up from the west. So فَبُهِتَ الَّذِي كَفَرْ. What happened? This believer was overwhelmed by astonishment. He realized Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Subhanallah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, we need to understand the true meaning of success and the true meaning of failure according to the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْر. What is khusr? What is khusr? Subhanallah. Four characteristics, if found present in your life, then you are truly successful and not from the losers. You need to have belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to have action. You need to encourage righteousness. You need to encourage patience. And subhanallah, our life should be divided into these categories. The following ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Except those that believe. What is belief? I mean, there is no faith without knowledge. We need to have belief and faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because knowledge is a component of faith. I mean, do we truly believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a sustainer? The Razzaq, the provider? Do we truly believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the healer? Do we truly believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the mujib, the one that's responsive and answers? Do we really believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the muqit, the one that nourishes the nourisher? Do we truly believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the hafidh, the preserver? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that all are losers except those that believe. So attending a gathering of knowledge is an investment in time. Using your time for what is good, for what is righteous, reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, contemplating over the verses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, contemplating over the blessings and the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is time well spent. Time well spent. Subhanallah, I mean, even reading a scientific journal that brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala falls in this category. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. Except those that believe. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that's the first condition. Every single one who does not want to be a loser must have belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second condition is وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ. You must perform good actions. Or actions that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made compulsory or recommended or desired. I mean, you give your wife her rights. Or you give your husband his rights. You earn a halal living. You bring food to your family. You provide them with clothing, take them to the doctor if they're sick. All these actions towards your family are عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ, righteous good deeds. But you got to have the right intention. You feed the poor, you help someone who's lost, you teach someone who's ignorant, you resolve a problem between two people, you remove harm from the road, you help someone that's old or disabled. All these fall under the category of performing good actions. And one of the best actions that we should do, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the work of prophets. Nuh alayhi salam, for 950 years, قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي دَعَوْتُ قَوْمِي لَيْلًا وَنَهَارًا. Oh Allah, I called my people to you, I called people to Islam, to the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, day and night. You pick up a friend and take him to the mosque, this is da'wah. You encourage a friend or a family friend to come with you to Fajr prayer, this is da'wah. You encourage someone to go with you for Taraweeh prayer in the month of Ramadan, this is da'wah. Every action needs to be righteous. And I mean, for the actions for us to be righteous, there are two conditions. It needs to be sincere for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it needs to be according to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the two conditions are, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا. So you have to have belief. And the second condition is عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. You must do good action. So you have to do this and that. And the third condition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala stipulates is وَتَوَاصَوْ بِالْحَقِّ. Encourage righteousness. Encourage and advise each other to perform good actions, not to cheat one another. Subhanallah, your tongue should only pronounce and say what is haq, what is right. Should call to the truth. The truth, you know, doesn't cut off sustenance. It doesn't bring death forward. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control of sustenance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one in control of death. And this actually adds to the meaning of da'wah and the importance of da'wah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرَجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ. That you are the best of nations produced as an example for mankind. Enjoining what is good and forbidding what is wrong and believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He also tells us another ayah, وَلْتَكُنْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. He says, and let there be arising from you a nation inviting to all that is good, enjoining what is right and forbidding that which is wrong, and all those will be successful. The father needs to advise his children. The mother needs to advise the children. The husband needs to advise the wife, and vice versa. The teachers should advise their children, and the students. We all need to be advocates of the truth. I mean, if a brother comes asking you for your opinion in riba, you must tell him the truth. Haram. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَأْذَنُوا بِحَرْبٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ. If you see a Muslim man committing a sin, like for example, shaking hands with a female, you must advise him with wisdom. If you speak, you must speak in a manner that's appropriate. If you hear someone backbiting, you must advise this person that this is not an act that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with. If you see a sister that's not in hijab, of course for the sisters, if they see a sister that's not in hijab or she's not wearing appropriate clothing, Islamic clothing, she must advise them. She must advise her sisters. This is a must. وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, you must, unless you want to be one of the losers, you must do تَوَاصِي بِالْحَقِّ. Enjoin what is righteous, what is right. So we all have, I mean, different people have different capacities to enjoin what is good and forbid what is evil. However, all of us must have a share in this so that we can be from the people who تَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ. And the fourth and last conditions is وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us that all mankind is in loss, except those that have these four characteristics. And this last one is encouraging patience. You need to be patient. You need to encourage others to be patient. SubhanAllah, ulama, they divide the patience into three categories. The first one is the patience on worship, praying every single day, fasting as much as you can, wudu every single time you want to pray, waking up for Fajr quite early. That requires patience. SubhanAllah, watawasaw bis-sabr is part of this. There's also patience from disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, staying steadfast on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said is halal and staying away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told you is haram. And there's also the patience of the qadr that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts you in a calamity or a test, you are patient. And this, and subhanAllah, the fasting combines these different types of patience. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us, fasting is half of patience. So if you are lacking in patience, then fasting is an advisable or is a good approach for you to conquer this problem that we must conquer. And subhanAllah, you are patient. And a beautiful example is that when we go to the dentist and the dentist is cleaning or drilling, I mean, you hold on tight to the chair and you bear the pain. Why? Because you know that there is benefit for you in this pain. You're convinced that the pain is temporary, but it has benefit for your teeth. And that should be the state of the Muslim. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him with a calamity, tests him with a financial difficulty, maybe he loses a loved one, he doesn't see the people, but he sees the Lord of the people. He says, Rabbul Ibad. He sees Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he sees it as a divine treatment or a therapy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. SubhanAllah, Ali ibn Abi Talib said that the importance of patience to deen is analogous to the importance of the head to the body. We all must have patience, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. It's one of the conditions that gives us the passing grade. Without patience, we cannot get the passing grade. We are failures. في خسر, in loss. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us and tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was subjected to so much suffering, torture and displacement, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him in the Quran, فَاصْبِرْ كَمَا صَبَرَ أُولُو الْعَزْمِ مِنَ الرُّسُلِ. He said, so be patient, O Muhammad. So were those of determination amongst the messengers, and do not be impatient for them. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our example, our leader, our role model, he was patient with his people. In Mecca for 13 years working tirelessly, patient with his own people. The number of people that migrated with him is so small compared to the 13 years of work, but he was patient. Look at the example of Taif. He was patient with the people of Taif. The angel of death, after the people of Taif started throwing the rocks at him and his feet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, started to bleed, he said his famous dua. Then Jibreel and the angel of the mountains came to him and told him, Ya Muhammad, لو شئت لأطبقت عليهم الأخشبين. If you please, Ya Muhammad, I will close these two mountains on them. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was patient with his people. And he said, أرجو أن يخرج الله من أصلابهم من يعبد الله لا يشرك به شيئا. That I hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring from their offspring people that say لا إله إلا الله and do not associate anyone with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it wasn't for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's patience, we wouldn't have Islam today. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our role model. Look at the Sahaba. Bilal radiallahu anhu, he was tortured. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because of his patience, raised him from being a slave to someone that until today we say radiallahu anhu, radiallahu anhu, radiallahu anhu, subhanallah. And on his deathbed, his wife started to cry. So he asked her, why are you crying? He said, غَدًا نَلْقَ الْأَحِبَّةِ مُحَمَّدًا وَصَحْبَةِ. After all his life of torture, all that struggling and suffering that he suffered, he says to his wife, tomorrow we meet the beloved ones, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his sahaba in Jannah, subhanallah. So Bilal radiallahu anhu understood the concept of patience. And wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, if it wasn't for their patience, we would not have this beautiful religion. The patience might change somebody's perception of Islam. Your patience might change somebody's life. One of the pious predecessors was asked, how long do I have to be patient for? He said, until you have both feet in paradise. SubhanAllah, once both feet are in paradise, then you can stop being patient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a beautiful surah, one of the shortest surah in the Quran, he says, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. We spoke about the importance of time and how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made the best of his time and utilized every single moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him to benefit the akhirah. And that's how we should be. We spoke about the meaning of loss and that you will lose everything in a second when the angel of death comes knocking on your door. Subhanallah, I mean, the irony is, there is an irony there that if you're late and you have to go somewhere and you want to do your salah quickly, what do? You read Surah Al-Asr. It's short and quick. And you recite, listen to the irony, you recite that time is running out and that you are in loss. SubhanAllah. You even find that some people, they have a portrait on the wall of Surah Al-Asr right next to the TV where they spend hours and hours and hours wasting their time watching television or watching the cricket or playing with their games. Human beings are in loss, and their greatest loss is time. SubhanAllah. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, whoever works hard on his dunya and gives it more time than he does for the akhirah, then he is in loss. SubhanAllah. And whoever works harder for his akhirah, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him both. He'll give him his dunya and the akhirah. We spoke about the true meaning of success and the true meaning of failure, as defined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his dictionary, subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you are steadfast in your belief of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, steadfast in righteous actions and on the truth, you are patient in your worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are patient in controlling your desires. You are patient on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has destined for you. Then you have truly met the objective of your existence and you will never be in loss. Subhanallah, Surah Al-Asr is very self-explanatory, has very simple meanings, but the true contest to attain, I mean, the vision and the perception that is applicable to the surah and to feel the true meaning of Iman. Subhanallah, always keep the surah in mind. Be mindful how you spend your time and ask yourself, this action that I'm about to do now, which category does it belong to? Does it belong to Amanu? Does it belong to Amilu Salihat? Does it belong to Tawasaw Bil Haq? Does it belong to Tawasaw Bil Sabr? Which category does it belong to? If it belongs to one of these categories, then go ahead with the action. If it doesn't, then don't waste your time with it. Your time is more valuable. SubhanAllah, in the business world, we hasten towards a good investment with high returns. And if we knew that an investment has a little return, we avoid it. Why don't we do the same when it comes to the Akhirah? Let us be intelligent about how we spend our time, how we spend our time in this dunya, so that we can gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and gain eternal happiness and eternal success in the hereafter, in the paradise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْعَصْرِ إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَفِي خُسْرِ إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاصَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. You are in loss unless you have the true belief. You partake in good actions, encourage righteousness, and encourage patience and practice patience. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those that act upon what they hear, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bring the true understanding of Surah Al-Asr into our lives. we say and end by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's dua, Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Thank you for tuning in, and until next time with the Deen team, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney Radio Program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.